Well, I'm so glad you're here. We have been believing God all week long that God will do some significant things this morning. That we're talking about activation. We're talking about the kingdom of God. We're talking about some things that God has in store for us as believers. You know, there's nothing worse than growing up playing sports all my life. There's nothing worse than being on the team but having to sit on the bench. I'm just saying, it's a horrible feeling. Now, that never happened to me. That happened to other people. I'm just teasing. I sat on the bench quite a bit in different sports. But I'm just here just to encourage you that, you know, the kingdom of God is not about superstars. It's about every person participating with what God's given them. And so we've been going through all these different things about the kingdom of God. And I'm just here just to encourage you this morning that you're not here by chance. Even those watching us on live streaming and other ways and things, that, you know, it's not by chance or coincidence that God's doing some things and he's drawing people. And we're living in a time and an age where that I believe the kingdom of God and what Jesus has in store for his church is going to be so spectacular, you don't want to miss it. You don't want to be sitting on the bench when God does some amazing things. We had, as another announcement real quick, is I see Pastor Lady down front. I think we had 46 people sign up for the chaplaincy program between the two churches. So that's a praise. So we'll be getting back to you. So see Pastor later for details if you have any questions, because we're going to get this thing up and running and seeing some God just move some incredible ways through the chaplaincy program. Having said that, I just want just to encourage you guys that, you know, when we come in for praise and worship, is that maybe the songs aren't exactly what you're used to, or maybe you're used to something different or whatever. But, you know, we consider worship time to be time like a prayer time. It's between you and God, letting God minister to you, getting cleansed from all the cares and worries of what you're going through, and just coming in where you're saying, Jesus, I just want to have time with you. And I would just encourage you to participate wholeheartedly. Don't be a spectator. Don't be just an observer. Let it be something that can just use the words of the songs and the things that are being played and sung. That let it be an expression of your heart to Jesus. Let it be a prayer request that you have before him. Let it be where he can just come and just minister to you. The worship is so much more than just kind of the pre-preaching part. Worship is all about who Jesus is and what he's done. And it's our way of acknowledging gratefulness to him. Can I get an amen? Are you guys here this morning? Amen. Let me just tell you, first service was awesome, man. We just had a great time. Didn't get done till almost 11 o'clock, but some of you are kind of coming in. They're just getting done. And I'm expecting God to do some incredibly similar things for this service. I believe that God is stirring the body of Christ. I believe that God is doing some unique things. And so I just want to encourage you that we're about 3 weeks out from when Jesus, Resurrection Sunday, April 1st, when Jesus 2,000 years ago came back from the grave. He says he spent 40 days telling his disciples about this thing called the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God is all about where you and I are today. The 2,000 years of church history help us to kind of identify some of the assets and characteristics of the kingdom. But the kingdom of God is more than just a church service. The kingdom of God is more than just people just coming and saying nice, pleasant things to one another as they come in and give a little money and then go home. The kingdom of God is your journey. It's your life call. It's where God's placed you, where he's equipped you, the gifts, the abilities, the talents that he's put in your life to use at this time and at this place to extend the influence of Jesus in our culture. And God knows that we need more. We need more influence of Jesus in our culture, not less. We need more people that are activated, more people that are inspired, more people that are motivated in the things of God, not less. And I can just tell you, just scripturally speaking, this is just always is a story we've been doing on Wednesday nights, talking more about the kingdom of God. But now I made a statement, and it was mostly true, but I left out one key detail. As you know, the Bible says when you follow Jesus, your future will get brighter and brighter. But if you're not following Jesus, I can tell you what God promises you is that your future gets darker and darker. And that's a reality. Would you say with me, and I think we'd have to agree, our culture today is worse in some ways for people who don't know Christ than it was 20 and 30 years ago. We're living in a time, unprecedented stuff is going on in our communities and in our culture. Guys, we need the body of Christ. We need the followers of Jesus to understand the time and the seasons we're living in, stepping up and saying, you know what, Jesus, use me, use my talent, use my life, use my gifts. God, allow me to be one that you could speak through and to bless and encourage the people that are around me. know, it's just so encouraging when you realize that when you're walking in the kingdom of God, listen to this. There's just some mind-boggling revelations came as Jesus spent that 40 days talking to his disciples. So I'm hoping to bring you back to that time, like 2,000 years ago. Jesus is resurrected. It's the greatest event in the history of mankind. And so our first verse we have here in Luke 16, verse 16, it says we have the law and the prophets, and then there came John. And then from John on, it says they began to preach about the kingdom of God. So you can pull the scripture up if you got it. And so one of the things about the kingdom of God, it says that people are pressing. Well, the kingdom of God, and you can talk about with Jesus, and this to me is such a revelation, said that men and women are equal in the kingdom of God. Men and women are equal. Now, to all the men in first century living, that was a bummer, because they felt superior in every way. They had the assets. They had all the things written in their name. They were the ones that could divorce their wife very easy in Jewish culture. Just say it three times. I divorce you, I divorce you, I divorce you. And the woman was left without any property, any recognition, any legal rights, or anything. I mean, it was all stacked for the men. And I can just tell you, if you go back through the Bible, you begin to realize that men and women both sinned before God. In fact, if I get into it just for a second, I'll just say it this way. When Adam and Eve made a choice to disobey God, the word of God is very clear that Eve thought she was doing the right thing. But the Bible says she was deceived. Adam didn't have any such illusions. Adam knew it was wrong. And Adam walked in rebellion. So deception for the woman and rebellion for the man. At least the deception part, you think you're trying to do the right thing. Are you guys hearing me? Rebellion is where you just out and out choose, I'm not doing that. I don't care what you say. I'm not going to do it. I don't care if it's the right thing. I'm rebellious, and that's our culture. We're a rebellious culture. So we can say that all men stand before God, men and women stand before God, guilty by the cross. Does everybody understand this? So that's why it's always interesting to me. As I talked last Sunday, we talked about stomping on the devil and just, you know, doing all kinds of stuff. You want to hear something embarrassing? The audio team told me, they said, Pastor Mitch, we had to cut your mic when you're up there dancing around. I said, why? They said, because it sounded like you're going to have a heart attack. I'm like, really? Wow. But the point is that as you realize that God's created you for victory, God's created you to win, God's created you to be an overcomer, and I'm saying this is that God created us male and female, and this is so strong because we have to have an identity. God created you the way it pleases him. That's why he made you female. That's why he made you male. And we have such an attack in our culture today on your gender identity. And I'm just telling you guys, if you follow the Lord, he will give you strength in the way that he's made you. He will give you courage to be the person he's called you to be. He'll give you the ability to fulfill everything he wants you to be in the gender that he's called you to be. That's why with the whole thing about male and female, and it's so distressing to me. We got through the message and I'm all done. Had multiple people come up to me, especially several women coming to me talking about their boyfriends or their husbands, their exes or whoever, used to beat them. And I'm like, guys, there is no place in the kingdom of God for that kind of behavior. There's absolutely zero tolerance to get physical. And just through the years of ministry, I've had wives that beat their husbands. That's even double embarrassing for the guy in a sense. And I'm just here just to encourage you and just say, you know, let's walk away from that kind of behavior. Let's be in a place, and I'm just saying that men need women, women need men, and we just both come together. We reflect fully the purpose of God and the character of God and who God is because of the way he's made us to shine together in equal proportions. I'll go a step further. In the church, did you know the Bible lists that women can be apostles and prophets? And evangelists and pastors and teachers, did you know that? Just to let you know what's in the Bible. There's all sorts of, if you read Romans 16, where Paul is calling out different people in the church of Rome, and he's talking about just specific things that they've done. He lists several women, and he talks about some of the things that they're responsible for, and they had a major voice, which is a radical, radical mindset in the first century. So let me tell you about some other radical mindsets that God's renewing in the body of Christ. God is teaching us, it says from the law and the prophets until John, it says that they had these things being preached. We know when Jesus began his public ministry, when his cousin John the Baptist began his public ministry, they both said the same thing. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. At hand means it's near, it means it's at hand. It's right here. kingdom of God. Well, if you think about it, up until that time, the Jewish culture had an incredible amount of teaching about the Ten Commandments. They had teaching about, and they had other laws to that, but they also taught about animal sacrifices and how that you had to bring in the best sheep or goat or bull that you could bring before the Lord, and you would sacrifice that unto him, and that the blood of that innocent animal would bring temporary cleansing to your conscience, therefore showing you and I the only way to get free from sin is through the sacrifice of blood. So when Jesus came and died on the cross, his blood sacrifice is what frees you and I from a guilty conscience and a condemning conscience and a conscience that keeps reminding us of all of our past failures. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus is the only antidote to sin. The name of Jesus is the authority God's given you to use that name when you're speaking for things for God, and you do it in the name of Jesus or in place of Jesus, and you declare by the name of Jesus. And so there's all these incredible revelations we've had for the last 2,000 years as a church. But if you go back to the first century and you're going through this, they didn't have a New Testament. All they had were Old Testament scriptures. So Jesus is spending 40 days just teaching his disciples, just downloading into them, this is the kingdom of heaven. This is a new world order. This is a divine mandate that God is doing on planet Earth, and you're the generators of it. You're the cause agents. You're the change agents. You're the ones that God is pressing to bring about changes on planet Earth. And it says that because of this thing, it says that the kingdom of God, it says, and everyone, it says that from John and Jesus on, it says they begin to preach not just animal sacrifices, not just Jewish culture, but they begin to preach the kingdom of God. It says, and everyone, listen to this scripture, everyone is pressing into it. I don't know if you have the scriptures up or not, but it says everyone's pressing into it. In the New Living Translation, it says this one, it says, everyone is eager to get in. So you have to say that as a church, we've done a very poor job of demonstrating kingdom life and kingdom living. Because right now, people aren't eager to get in. You know, it's like a Black Friday sale. Do you know people who get up at 2 and 3 in the morning to go stand for an hour or 2 hours in front of a store door so they can get in to buy the right type of toy or right type of gift for their loved ones? Yeah. Did you know that Black Friday is where people get so excited, so amped up, that they'll just do all these special things to go? They're eager to get in. Or like when people on Thursday night or Friday night or Saturday night, downtown State College, they go to the bars. And there are hundreds of students lined up eager to get in to that place where they can drink and socialize. Are you guys with me this morning? Is that not true? Then you come over to the kingdom of God and everybody's like, no way, man. Go to church on a Sunday morning? Are you kidding me? You want me to go on Wednesday nights? Have you lost your mind? This is America. This is the land of the free, man. I don't have to do any of that stuff. Because we as a church community have made the kingdom of God not attractive. And when you feel like, when you realize the kingdom message and what Jesus was telling his disciples to do, you realize, God, you're so amazing. Because it means that, listen to this, every talent, every ability, every skill that God's deposited or you've used in your life can be used for kingdom purposes. It's more than just Sunday morning. The New Living Translation says people are just eager to get in. You know, I went to a concert the other night. It was Tuesday night in Pittsburgh. They had a band called the Passion Band. They were here. They had a couple of speakers, maybe heard on the radio, a guy named Louis Giglio and another guy named Levi Lesko, and they were there sharing, and the band was there. Before the concert ever started, there were people lined up, couldn't wait to get in. You know what? I know we'll have revival at Christ Community Church when the front row gets filled with seats. I'll just know that it'll be revival. That I know it'll be revival. We have to bring out more chairs because people are just eager to get in. I know it's going to just be some incredible, outstanding thing. In fact, I'll tell you a quick story. I had a good friend of mine. His name was Rosie Greer. He used to play football here. Rosie was out in California. He wasn't a believer. His family, I won't go through this whole story. His family had gotten right with God. They were going to this large church there in inner city Los Angeles, and they invited him to come. And he says, I'm not interested in church. I don't want to go. You know, he'd been a football player and an actor and had all this stuff going for him. And they said, no, you need to come. You need to come. So finally, his son, Rosie Jr., got him to come. So Rosie said, okay, I'll come to church. Listen to this. They said, in order to come to the church service, you have to get there an hour early to stand in line so after the first service is over, then you can get in. There's only it's so big and there's so many people pressing to get in to this church service. He said, have you lost your mind? I'm not interested in going, and I certainly don't want to stand for an hour to wait to get into the church service. I'm not going to do it. But they kept after him and kept after him until finally Rosie just said, okay, I'll go. So he went, stood in line for an hour, came into the service, listened to the speaker. And if you ever listened, these guys are just some powerful messages going on. But Rosie didn't know the Bible. And the guy was quoting John 3:16. So Rosie said he opened his Bible and he found the index. You know, he's going through it, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. He's reading through there. Finally gets over to the other New Testament, Matthew, Mark. Oh, there it is, John. Then he kept reading. Well, there's 1 John, 2 John. He then said, what John's he talking about? So he finally got over to John 3:16 about that time the service was over. And he talked about just how he didn't understand a lot of stuff and a lot of stuff went by him. But it was more impressive is that the intensity or the eagerness of the congregation to come and hear the word of God. And I must say that we have done a very poor job as a church community of presenting the biblical Jesus. We've been too busy talking about social issues and political issues and not getting into the spiritual issues, which is the word of God. So as Jesus is speaking about the kingdom of God, there's just some things that God wants to activate within us. And this is what I love about the kingdom message. Every single gift, every single person is not a bench warmer. You are in the game. Your gifts and your talents and your abilities, God can use for kingdom purposes. I love it when people in our marketplace and people who are in their businesses and entrepreneurs that are out and they're just going about their daily business and they're just doing their work, and all of a sudden God opens doors and they begin to minister to people and pray for people and share with people and seeing Jesus bring his peace and love and joy into different situations. People who've lost a loved one and they're mourning and full of grief, and one of our guys in the marketplace just begins to pray for them and God begins to heal them. People that are clients and others coming in to buy different products, and all of a sudden God just uses and opens the door, and the people who are kingdom oriented begin to pray and minister to that person, and God fills them with his love and his peace. How many know that you're excited about the kingdom of God? That's kingdom living. That's where you understand it's more than just coming on Sunday morning and listen to Joe Bloom and the Bloomettes sing. It's a lot more than that. There's a lot more joy than just coming and hearing just great messages. You realize every day of the week, I get to be a participant in the kingdom of God. Every day of the week, and there's just people just eagerly just pressing in to kingdom life. Well, listen to what the word says. The Bible tells us in Matthew 10, the next verse it says, as you go saying, you're to be active in the kingdom. You're to take your gifts, take your talents, and use them to the glory of God. It says, as you go, it says, as you go preach saying, the kingdom of heaven is where? Near. The kingdom of heaven is right here. If you love Jesus, you're a kingdom man or you're a kingdom woman. And what does it say you're to do? Listen to what it says. It says you're to what? To heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the leprosy, drive out demons. Freely you've received, freely give. How many like those? I love those words. It says you're to what? To heal, raise, cleanse, and drive. Those are action words. God wants you and I to be active. That means when we encounter things, I'm just telling you, we encounter things, there is nothing that can resist the name of Jesus. And there is nothing that the blood of Jesus can't cleanse. It gets out every sin. It gets out every stain. It gets out every disappointment. The blood of Jesus does his work. The blood of Jesus renews. The blood of Jesus cleanses. The blood of Jesus restores. The blood of Jesus causes you and I to realize that we're accepted and adopted into the family of God. The blood of Jesus, and you realize what qualifies me to be a representative of God is not my abilities and not my talents. It's the blood of Jesus and the name of Jesus. And because of those things, therefore, I can dare to take risk in Jesus' name. So we had this past spring, a bunch of our students went down and still going to the beach and drinking and partying and doing all the stuff that college students do over spring break. They went to the slums of Georgia, went in and began to minister. So one of our students, Anthony, just we prayed for him earlier, he's graduating, talks about his experience he had as a kingdom of God man and doing what he did. So we'll play that video.
Good morning, Christ Community Church. My name's Anthony. I'm the president of the College Ministry Victory Christian Fellowship, and I just wanted to share with you a testimony from our spring break trip from a few weeks ago. So we were out doing street evangelism one day. We came up on a family who was sitting out on their porch. We asked if we could pray for them, and they agreed. So while we're praying, I start feeling this sort of tingling in my wrist. And once the prayer concluded, I asked if anybody in the family had wrist pain. And the mother said that her daughter did. I asked what it was like. She said it was on a scale of 1 to 10, about a 4. and that it had been bothering her for about 6 or 7 months now. So I asked if I could lay my hand on her wrist and pray for her, and she agreed, and I did. And after the prayer, I asked how it was doing. She said, there's absolutely no pain. She starts flopping it around and testing it out. God took her pain away completely, totally healed her wrist. So I hope that this testimony encourages you guys to step out when you hear from the Lord and just watch him show up in your life. God bless. Have a great Sunday.
Amen. Let me read you another verse that I think is very challenging to us. In Luke 19:26, Jesus quotes the parable about the talents, and he says, yes, the king replied, and to those who use well, everybody say use well, those who use well what they are given, even more will be given. But to those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. You see, God's given every one of you gifts and talents and abilities. I believe it starts first in the natural. I believe that the talent that God's given you or the ability God's given you, you're using it. Maybe God's called you to be an electrician, or God's called you to be an engineer, or God's called you to be a scientist or doctor or whatever field he's called you, business, whatever he's called you into, that I believe that you need to believe God that you're going to be the head and not the tail, that you're going to take your talents and abilities and you're going to be the best employee, that you're going to be the one that's on time, you're going to be the one with a cheerful attitude, you're going to be the one who will take the dirty jobs and not complain. Hello? You're going to be the one to stay after church and help stack chairs. Yes. Okay. There's just all kinds. I'm just trying to say all kinds of natural things you can do just to say, God, I just want you to use me, and I'll just use it any way I can. And as you are faithful in the natural, God, I'm telling you, will open doors for spiritual ministry. It works. It goes hand in hand. So every gift, every talent, every ability counts in the kingdom of God. So people who are in the marketplace, I just shared that earlier, people who are in the marketplace, that God's given the ability, and I'm just saying this, and I spoke it prophetically first service, I'm going to say it again this service, God will give you the ability to generate hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars, and not all of that is for you. I'm putting my stake and claim out there for Christ's community. We will be glad for you to prosper enormously, to be able to bless gigantically out of your financial resources the projects that God has us do. That's all part of kingdom living. But it starts with excellence. The Bible says in Proverbs, it says, you see a man that's skilled in his work, says he will not stand before ordinary man, he'll stand before kings. You put excellence to what you're doing, and you make sure you're doing it right, doing it to the best of your ability, I'm telling you, doors will open. However, like the old saying goes, if you don't use it, you're going to lose it. You know, say this about, like we know about muscle mass, we know in the natural, if you don't develop your muscles, they'll atrophy, and before you know it, you won't have a lot of muscular strength. So the same thing it is when you have things in the spiritual realm, and God's blessed you. Did you know God the Father has given you gifts, God the Son has given you gifts, and God the Holy Spirit has given you gifts? You are a gifted people. God the Holy Spirit has given you some incredible opportunities. And we're living in a day and an age where, guys, I'm telling you, I can't think of a better place to be than to be a follower of Jesus Christ, knowing that he can use my gifts and my talents and my abilities, kingdom living, kingdom entrepreneurship out in the community, letting God just use me to bless people and encourage people. You know, there's nothing more exciting than when you're not, quote, in a church setting and someone begins to minister to you, and all of a sudden the word of the Lord comes and God begins to give you insight and encouragement, and God begins to give you words of life to minister to people, and God just uses you, and all of a sudden you're just as blessed as the person receiving ministry. And that's why God's encouraging you. He's trying to encourage us. He says, I need you as a community, as a body of believers. I need you guys to continue to exercise, be faithful with what I've given you. Don't worry about if your gift is not as big as someone else. Let me just give you a practical example. See, a lot of people want to get up on stage and preach, and I appreciate that, and I'm glad to do that Wednesday nights or Wednesday night services, or we'll just have a great time for people to share and just have their life experiences. But you know, a lot of times, ministry up here starts in the back room or just in your home, and you're just ministering to people who are unseen and unheard. A lot of times it happens, you just open up your home and let people come in and just start small groups and just one-on-one discipleship, and you're just pouring out to people and just sharing with people and just encouraging people. A lot of times ministry takes place not in the big moments, but in the small, mundane moments of life. And God just opens doors, and God just does some incredible things in those moments. Man, don't you know it's just so much fun when God begins to speak to you and God begins to minister through you, and all of a sudden God just used you. And I tell you, there's been multiple times I've just walked away from different situations where I just felt just so blessed. Had a thing the other night. I was just sitting here on the couch. I was watching some kind of sports, probably basketball or something. And I just kept feeling the Lord just told me to send a text to this guy in our church. And I was like, yeah, it's kind of late. I don't send people texts after 9 o'clock. It's like, no, it's like, you know, 9:30, 9:45, something like that. And I'm kind of having this argument with the Lord, send this guy a text. I'm like, I don't want to. I just don't want to send him a text. I just, you know, think I'm some kind of stalker or something. You know, just, I don't know what to. But I feel like the Lord just said, just send him a text. So I did. I just sent him a text. I said, hey, just want you to know, I'm praying for you and praying that you make the right decision. He was going through some incredible pressures in home life and some stuff. And, you know, and then he got back to me the other day. And he says, you won't believe it. He says, right before you texted, I had this family situation blow up in my face, and I'm sitting there trying to figure out what to do, and your text came. And all of a sudden, I knew the Lord was in this. I knew the Lord would get me through it. He says, I'm so thankful that you're obedient to the Lord. You see, guys, it's not in the big moments. It's not in the flashy kind of preaching. It's just being sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Letting God just use you just to minister to people. What do you minister to people? Well, for a lot of people, they feel condemned. So you got to talk to them about who God is. He's a righteous God, and he can make you righteous through the blood of his son, Jesus. That it's not a religion, it's a relationship. That when you come to Christ, and because of the cross, you can stand before God as if you have never sinned. Powerful, powerful revelation. Or for some people, believe it or not, coming to church, they just need a little joy. And they just need you to have a little joy in your life. You know, I was reading this article the other day, and they were talking about the stress that Americans are under. And they said that usually that the way people vent their stress is through cursing. I know it's never happened to anybody here, but I've heard people out there do that. And they say, like, by 11 o'clock in the morning, people are just cursing up a storm. They're swearing over the economy, over the future. They're just swearing and all this stuff. Hopefully, as a Christ follower, you can give God praise instead of cursing. I was driving down the road the other day. In fact, we're coming back from that concert Tuesday night, and this blessed man in his pickup truck came behind us with his brights on. And I said out loud, I said, I wish that idiot would turn his brights off. I just said it in the car. And the Lord rebuked me. He said, how dare you call another person made in my image an idiot? I said, well, he was. But anyway, I just said, God, I'm so sorry. I said, Lord, bless that man. I hope he gets to where he's going. And maybe we need to slow down a lot more so it passes. You know, it was just so irritating just having. But I'm just saying, but when you realize that God's called you to be a blessing, the kingdom of God, righteousness and joy, how about peace? You know, people get stressed out over everything. Man, just need kingdom people. Don't be stressed. Just move in God's peace. Just move in a different realm. And it says the kingdom of God was so attractive that people were eager to get into it, wanted to participate, wanted to be a part of this kingdom life. And that's when you realize that, man, this thing is so much bigger than just a Sunday morning church service. It's so much broader than just kind of just coming in and just hearing great messages, singing wonderful songs. That there's just this life, there's this pulsating activation that the Holy Spirit does to true followers. All of a sudden you realize, man, Jesus, I just love you so much. I just keep pressing into you. The Bible tells us in Hebrews 5:14, the next verse, it goes on to say this. It says, but solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. And I shared this as I was a college student. You know, I used to work in this national pizza chain called Pizza Hut. I used to make pizza crust, thick, thin crust, all kinds of stuff, you know. And I got pretty good at making pizza crust. How many know that I was in college a long time ago? And if you were to put me back in the kitchen now making pizza crust, it probably wouldn't be too good. Why? Because I'm not using that skill anymore. But back in the day when we'd have a rush, usually from 4:30 to 6:30, dozens and dozens and dozens of people coming in and pizzas and flying out and all this stuff. Man, we could crank out those pies, man. We could just make them, just get them going. We didn't have conveyor ovens. We had to stick our arms all the way back in the ovens, burn ourselves, burn all my eyebrows, eyelashes. It was unbelievable what the cooks go through. So next time you go into a pizza restaurant, bless your cook, okay? He's paying the price to get your food out. But I'm saying as I was going through, I was just thinking about, you know, it's just funny how you just lose things. You don't use it, you lose it. Spiritually speaking, let me just say this. If you're not actively pursuing Jesus in the word and prayer, fellowship with other believers, looking for opportunities to influence the kingdom of God and your area of influence extended through your life, I can just tell you right now, you're going to lose some stuff. You're going to be disappointed. And for a lot of us, we just don't have a real confidence in the things of God. We're just not for sure that Jesus is working with us. And this is what I love about kingdom men and kingdom women, because God always stretches you beyond your natural abilities and talents. God always pushes you a little further than your comfort zone. And you begin to realize, now look at my journey of faith and how God led me into this place where I'm at, where we're just praying for the sick and casting out demons and praying for inner healing and deliverance and all this spiritual stuff and asking people to get baptized in the Holy Spirit and releasing the gift of tongues in people's life and seeing people come to Jesus and just traveling the world and doing all this stuff. Man, it's just little steps. But then you just have this expectation, you know what, if God can use me, he can use you. And you realize as you follow God and pursue him, then he opens up these doors that you never would have gotten to because you were faithful to use what he's given you. And as you're faithful with that, he will give you more. So let me tell you just a practical gift that God's given every believer. Are you ready? You ready for this? Practical gift. Every believer, every follower of Christ. Listen to what it says in 1 Corinthians 14:1. It says, pursue this love with eagerness. Make it your goal, yet earnestly desire. Let me stop here. Earnestly desire would be the same words we'd use for lust or zeal. Make it your earnest desire. Be zealous for this. What is it? To be zealous, it says to cultivate the spiritual gifts to be used by believers for the benefit of the church, especially that you may prophesy. For in this way, you can all prophesy, verse 31, one by one, so that everyone may be instructed and everyone may be encouraged. Wouldn't it be great to have a church where people were gifted in the prophetic? That when you came through the doors, that people just had words for you or you had words for others? That by supernatural, that God would just encourage you, that God would inspire you, that God the Holy Spirit, as you're coming in to service, all of a sudden, you know, you're kind of thinking about some things, maybe you're a little bit down, a little bit worried, a little stressed over something, and God just activates three or four people, and they all come up and just tell you similar things, and all of a sudden you realize, God knows me. God knows what I'm going through. God knows that I needed these words, and all of a sudden God uses. And I'm telling you this, on the other side, you're available to let your ear hear. God points out someone and says, I want you to share with this person, minister to this person, and declare to this person, be a friend to this person. Just share, and all of a sudden the word of the Lord. And all of a sudden when everybody gets done with church, man, they're all encouraged. Why? Because every person in the body took advantage of the gifts that God's given them. God says you can all prophesy one by one. Everyone can speak a word of encouragement. You can speak a word of peace, a word of joy to others. You can just see God the Holy Spirit just engage. And God the Holy Spirit just begin to teach. And God the Holy Spirit just begin to instruct. And when you come in, it's supernatural. I was down yesterday, met with a guy. We're talking about our outreach to Madagascar. We'll do in somewhere in the year 2019. And this guy has multiple churches, and God's doing some amazing things. He's a pastor out of Baltimore, Pastor Bart. And he just began to talk about the prophetic. And he shared about one time that he was in this country in Africa, and he's speaking to a large gathering of believers and ministers. And this one dignified gentleman came in and sat down in the front row, and he said right in the middle of it, God just stopped and began to prophesy over this man. And he gave him a scripture out of Proverbs that says that you're not going to be the king, but you're going to be the king's counselor, and the king's counselor will have more influence than the king. We didn't know it at the time, but the man who walked in was the vice president of the nation. And he brought all these state cameras with him as they'd come in. And so Pastor Bart gave him the word of the Lord. The guy came up afterwards and spoke as he addressed the convention. He said, I just want you to know that thanks to Pastor Bart, you've now made an announcement to the rest of the nation. I will not be running for president of the country. 2 weeks ago in our prayer closet, God spoke to my wife and I that I'm not to assume the office of presidency, but I'm to be a consultant to the president. The word of the Lord came to pass. Have another situation, just to let you know how valuable it is, the word of the Lord, to treasure it. We have another guy in our church, I'm not going to name names, but he's told this story publicly, you probably know what I'm talking about. But he talked about that he'd been retired for a while, he and his wife had bought all these rental properties, 20 rental properties. He'd been trading in the market. The market turned against him and he lost everything. All 20 rental properties gone. Nest egg IRA gone. His house was in debt. The IRS was sending out agents to repossess his house. How many know that's critical circumstances? And another man in another church called him up and said, hey, the Lord told me you're to get back into investing in stocks. He said, are you crazy? My wife will divorce me. I've already lost everything. I don't have anything left. We are so far in debt, we can't even pay attention, let alone anything else. He says, I don't know what to tell you. He says, the Lord told me you're to get back into trading stocks, so go do it. So he said he was looking through a file a couple days later, and he found that he had, I think, $1,500 worth of stocks in some Chinese company. And he and his wife talked. She said, yeah, but that's all you get. All you get is that little stock, that's $1,500. That's it. And if you ever traded stocks, you know that's not a lot to work with. But over the course of several weeks, months, and years, he turned his financial situation around where the God has blessed him. He paid off all of his debts, got out of Hawk, has an incredible investment, IRA, investing, doing all this stuff, and God has used him immensely to bless the body of Christ through the ability to trade stocks. The word of the Lord will come to pass. When you're sensitive to letting Jesus use you and speak through you, activate those spiritual gifts. Listen to what it says in Romans as we close. It says this in Romans 12:6. God's marvelous grace imparts to each one of us varying gifts and ministries that are uniquely ours. So if God has given you the gift grace of prophecy, you must activate your gift by using the proportion of your faith you have to prophesy. So the Bible's very clear that we all have spiritual gifts. It's just that we need to use them. And that's what I'm here to stir. I'm here to activate. That's what Jesus was telling his disciples and about the kingdom of God. It's all about activation. It's about allowing the Spirit of God in you to use you to bless others. Here's what happens when you begin to use your spiritual gifts. You begin to bless others, but you yourself are also blessed. I can't begin to tell you the number of times I've felt defeated, discouraged, worn out, and God will just give me a word of encouragement for somebody else. And I'll just go give it out of obedience and faith to what the Lord's saying, and the next thing you know, I feel encouraged. And even when that person received the encouragement, God used that to use it to encourage me. And I begin to realize that, guys, when you begin to move in the supernatural, begin to move in the spiritual, begin to move in letting God move through you and God endorse you and God do these incredible things, all of a sudden you realize that, man, I'm so encouraged. And the things that you need, like you need love and joy and peace and all those things, I'm just telling you, it's all in the kingdom of God. It's all in the Spirit. And you begin to give beyond yourself and begin to share and minister and love people and open your homes or open in the business world or in the marketplace or wherever God's placed. You just begin to let God just flow through you in that way. God supernaturally will endorse you. He will be with you. He will provide for you. He will not let your words fall to the ground. I've got so much more about the prophetic, but all I can just encourage you is that when you come to services, come ready to give. Come ready to share. Come ready to say, Jesus, Lord, just let me be an encouragement to those around me. Because we all go through discouraging times. People going through divorces. People going through financial crisis. People going through emotional upheaval in their life. People going through, people that have died in their family. People going through all these worries and stresses. I mean, guys, everybody here, we're all fighting the same battles. And it just takes one little word from Jesus, one little Spirit-led believer just to say a little word. I'm praying for you. I was thinking about you. Hey, I just want you to know, the Lord says, and you just begin just to flow in what the Holy Spirit's given to you, and God just does some amazing things. I had a couple that just came up to me after first service, just came and said, Pastor Mitch, we'd like for you to prophesy over us. And to my knowledge, I'd never seen them before in my life. I said, okay, let's just see what the Lord does. And so we just began to get together and just seek God. And one of the things that came out of the prophetic word, I said, I think God's given you both just a counseling gift. I'm just telling you, God's called you to be counselors. Well, come to find out, they both were counselors in the state prison. God knows. It's amazing when you just let the Holy Spirit just begin to run through you. God just begins to speak and minister, and people just get touched. So here's what I felt like this morning. All week long, I've been praying over this and just thinking about this. Every gift and every talent counts. Has everybody got that? Doesn't matter if you're an engineer or you're working as a plumber or you're working wherever God's called you. You can bless people, and you can encourage people, and you can see God do some amazing things. Then as you're faithful with your natural skills, God will give you in the Spirit, He'll give you ways to bless people and encourage people. And I'm telling you, words from the Lord matter. In fact, let me tell you another cool story. Yesterday I was with this group of ministers, and one of the guys there was a young man. He's a youth minister. And he told me, he says, my name is Kitely. I said, really? He says, yeah, my name's Patrick Kightley. I said, is your dad David Kightley? He goes, yeah, that's my dad. I said, 28 years ago, listen to me, church, 28 years ago, when we started Christ Community Church, I had three prophets come in to our first service. One of them's name was David Kightley. 28 years ago, his dad prophesied over this church, declared the things that God was going to do. I've got it written out word for word. I still hang on some of those words that were spoken when we started Christ Community Church. Still treasure some of the things that were said by those men of God that God wanted to do through this church and in our community. I can just tell you, people come in here all the time. We got all these, I saw Todd Horner sitting in the back. He's running a volleyball group and doing a great job. We got basketball in here. We got all kinds of soccer groups in here, all this stuff. And I can just tell you, people that come in that know where we started from and where we're at now, they just come in and say, Mitch, you are so blessed by God. You are so blessed by God. Everything we have here, I'm telling you, is a gift from Jesus. I didn't deserve it. I didn't earn it. All the stuff going on, all I can tell you, it's a gift from Jesus. The reason the successes we've seen, the hundreds of people, thousands of people we've sent out as we prayed for the graduating seniors, sent them out all over the world. All over the world, we have people who come to Christ Community Church. We have people in Seoul, Korea. We got people in Africa. We got people in Asia. People in Central America, South America. All over who've come to Christ Community. We've had a small part in training and discipling them. Man, what an incredible joy it is to be with a community of faith to say, Jesus, we're so glad you're alive. We're so glad you've risen from the dead. We're so glad as we're here this morning that God, it's not by accident, it's not by coincidence, that God, you've brought us here for such a time as this. God, use me, activate me. So if you guys would stand with me, here's how we're going to do it. We're going to do a little different altar call this morning. I believe the Lord wants to create activation. And by activation is, I don't know what the Lord's going to speak to you, but if you will come forward, stand here at the altar with me, we're going to let God the Holy Spirit speak to you and let him activate in your life the spiritual gifts that he's placed within your life. He's given to every single believer. I'm telling you, every single believer. Ephesians 4:8, when Jesus rose from the dead, it says he ascended on captivity captive, and it says, and he gave gifts to men. The Lord has gifts to give to you. There are spiritual gifts, natural gifts, relational gifts. I'm just telling you, there's some supernatural things God's going to open for you. As we humble ourselves this morning, as we stand before him, we're going to say, God, Holy Spirit, come and speak to your children, speak to your bride, speak to us. God, we just thank you this morning. Church, just agree with me that God, the Holy Spirit, will do some amazing things. Just believe with me this morning that as you're standing in agreement, that God, the Holy Spirit, will just speak so loud and clearly to you. I responded to an altar call years ago, and the Lord just spoke to him to stand over in the corner of the room as a young man. The Lord just said, I've called you to be a prophet to the nations. I told him then I didn't like that word. And I'm just telling you, you can have arguments with God, but it's come to pass. And I can just tell you, it's been confirmed over and over and over and over again, all the things that God has done. So we're just standing here this morning. This is between you and God, activation. Saying, Holy Spirit, speak to me. Holy Spirit, speak to me. Holy Spirit, reveal your kingdom purposes in my life. Let the Lord just speak to you the things that he's treasured, the things he wishes to impart to you in this moment. Maybe it's a teaching gift. Maybe it's an evangelism gift. Maybe it's gifts of healing. Maybe it's counseling, like I said. Maybe God's giving you deliverance ministry. Maybe the Lord's got some areas for you in the marketplace where he wants you to be successful and prosper. Maybe the Lord's got you in a place where he's got a nation. He's called you to be a missionary. I feel that very strongly with this group. Who is that? Who feels called to the nations? I sense that. If you've been called to the nations, anybody else over here called to the nations? Guys, raise your hands. I want to pray for you. This is a word from the Lord. Lord, you see these hands, these ones that have been called to the nations. Father, it's a holy moment. So, Lord, we just stand before you. Lord, we recognize the divine call. Father, we thank you that you, Lord, that you prepare us, train us, and equip us, and then send us. So, Father, these that have their hands raised, that have called to the nations, Father, we bless that. We honor that. Father, we pray this morning, Lord, you continue to do your work. Seal the word in their hearts. Don't let it get stolen. Father, no matter where they're going, training, disappointments, all those things that happen, Father, we thank you, your word will come to pass. eyes. In Jesus' name, we agree. Church, stretch forth your right hand of faith. This is important. This is critical. Lord, all the ones that raise their hand for a call to the nations, Father, we agree with them. Church, you got to agree. Lord, we agree that God, in your right time, in the right place, that God, that you will release them, Lord, either with a team or be the head of a team or however you release them. But God, they will be released to speak, teach, preach, go. If it's in the marketplace, if it's in evangelism or spiritual things, but Father, in any way, in the name of Jesus, Father, we agree, we bless, we confirm your word to these ones in Jesus' name.